Animals develop faster than man. A horse can run a few hours after its birth, reaches puberty in its second year of life, and is fully developed by around the age of 6. When does a child reach maturity? If it's a boy, sometimes never. Indeed, that is our hallmark, that we can always learn and develop. Most mammals, including many primates, begin to grow teeth in the womb. The second teeth follow soon thereafter, beginning in the second year with most monkeys, for example. Some species of larger monkeys reach reproductive maturity in the fifth year. Smaller monkeys usually by the end of the second. With man, on the other hand, teething begins in the second half of the first year and lasts into the third year. Then there is a long pause. During this time, the teeth remain in place, allowing the child to master speech. The second teeth come in from the sixth or seventh year until the tenth. The ability to reproduce is or used to be reached around the 14th year. The problem of acceleration in recent times can only be mentioned here. Not shown in this diagram is the emergence of the wisdom teeth, which typically happens between the ages of 17 and 38 years. From this point of view, is man really the best adapted? On the contrary, he remains helpless and needy for years. There is no true menopause in animals. A woman, on the other hand, can live beyond biological fertility to continuing psychological and spiritual development. Animals are more complete than man in their development. Man is the most unfinished. With completion comes a hardening. Compare the shoulders, elbows, wrists, and knuckles shown here. The farther the primates diverge from man, the more they are hardened at birth. The so-called tegula of apes is something between a human nail and a claw. Creatures with claws start life with something like fingernails and then develop away from what is human. Hence the fossil sequence. The animals appear first because they hardened too quickly. The initial predisposition toward humanness is overwhelmed by specialization. That is adaption. With the hardening come other kinds of fixations too. Last time, we looked at the tendency of the animal to grow a snout. This organ of craving binds the animal instinctively to its particular food. A land animal lives with its hind legs bent. This maintains a tension, binding it to its particular manner of locomotion. That is, the animal is governed by a movement drive seated in its body. With the binding comes a suffering. Try, if you will, being hunched for a while, stooped. Then rise upright and feel the freeness. Man and animal both feel pain, because both have astral bodies, but only by means of the eye can we overcome pain. We can understand how long it is likely to last, and what it is good for. Every pain we overcome becomes a means of higher development. The beasts must suffer the pain and cannot overcome it. As noted in the presentation on the kingdoms of nature, they have made a sacrifice. This realization can lead to a feeling of loving responsibility toward them. An echinoderm larva, shown here on the left in the example of one of the larval stages of the sea cucumber, has a bend at the beginning of its intestinal tract. That is, the mouth is perpendicular to the body axis. Only man retains this curvature. The diagram shows the larva from the side. On the right is a mature sea cucumber. It has undergone what is called a regressive metamorphosis. Know thou thyself. The next step in the enhancement is the tunicate larva, shown here in the upper left in the example of a sea squirt. The neural crests merge into a rudimentary neural tube. The notochord appears. Front and back are more clearly distinguished. On the right is a mature sea squirt. After metamorphosis, the tunicates retain the bilateral symmetry, but lose the new dorsal organs and the elongated form. Again, a regressive metamorphosis. That is, the larva, which approaches the level of a chordate, is more advanced than the adult. In the words of Daniel Dennett, the juvenile sea squirt wanders through the sea searching for a suitable rock or hunk of coral to cling to and make its home for life. For this task, it has a rudimentary nervous system. When it finds its spot and takes root, it doesn't need its brain anymore, so it eats it. It's rather like getting tenure. The marine invertebrate larva has bilateral symmetry, neural crests, and an alimentary canal with an angle in its initial portion. The echinoderm metamorphosis involves loss of all three of these fundamental traits. In groups appearing later, less and less is lost. The enhancement continues to the vertebrates, which retain the bilateral symmetry, the elongated form, and the distinction between front and back. That is, they embody the three dimensions. These are fully realized in man, in whose body, up and down, right and left, and forward and backward, are inscribed as a cross. Evolution is human from the very beginning. Man appeared last on Earth, yet is the guiding principle of evolution.